Welcome everyone. Welcome to the 16th of the Reimagining series of webinars. The series aims to steer discussions around specific sectors examining the impact of COVID-19, particularly on people and environment, and initiates conversations on various aspects of reimagining the sector from these specific experiences with an aim to consolidate a set of demands and policy asks in the short term and continuing conversations for greater transformations in these sectors, which are people-centric, democratic, equitable, and sustainable. Today's webinar is on reimagining education for equitable, democratic, and inclusive society, given in the context of about 90% of the children currently out of school and almost half of them girls. In India, it is estimated that 320 million children have been affected by school closure. Will COVID pandemic erase some of the gains in education which have been attained in the recent past, given people are slipping back into poverty and joblessness on one hand and school closures on the other? The lockdown has compounded educational inequalities and exclusion, increasing the learning gaps for children of economically and socially disadvantaged sections of society. While private and allied schools have started online classes, many in the government schools are left out, leading towards a digital divide in education. The new ways of learning have robbed the children of much needed face-to-face social interaction, and schools as a social and physical space for collective learning, living, playing, etc. The disruptions caused by technology in the education sector may drive it further down the pathways of privatization and education content being created by private companies and app companies gradually changing education into a commodity to serve the capital interest. Today's webinar will discuss around these issues, and we have a wonderful set of speakers, including student activists, right to education campaigners, academicians, and policymakers. The session will be moderated by Ms. Annie Namala, who will introduce the speakers. This webinar has been coordinated and co-organized with the National Right to Education Forum, or RT Forum, who campaigns for proper implementation of RT Act and beyond. Before introducing the moderator, there are a few logistics announcements. All participants are in a default mute mode. Questions could be typed in the chat box and will be taken up after all the presentations. Please type the questions, and these questions will also be sent to the moderator, who will then transmit the questions to the speakers. It would be nice if you could write in the box itself whom the question is intended to. There is simultaneous translation happening in Hindi and English, and this could be tuned in by turning to French language. The details have been sent to all the participants and it will be pasted in the chat box now. For all the speakers, we request you to kindly speak slowly so that the interpreters can translate what you say. For if anybody is planning to tweet, please tweet using hashtag reimagining the future or hashtag post-COVID economy, hashtag right to education. Now let me introduce the moderator. Annie Namala is the Executive Director for Center for Social Equity and Inclusion, CSEI, and has been active in the fight for Dalit rights, dignity, and inclusion of marginal communities in social, political, and development processes. She has worked extensively in building community-based organizations, networking, training, and advocacy, and engaged in policy and advocacy work with state, national governments, and bilateral and UN agencies, particularly in the area of right to education and child rights. Annie Ma'am served as a member of National Advisory Council for the implementation of RTE Act in 2010 and has chaired the subgroup on equity and inclusion. She has worked for universal and inclusive education with focus on marginalized communities as part of her work in Right to Education Forum. She pioneered the work on monitoring inclusion of children from disadvantaged and weaker sections in private unaided schools to foster social justice and inclusion. Currently, she also acts as the convener of Vadana Todo Abhiyan, a large civil society network working against poverty and monitoring sustainable development goals. An able activist, researcher, and a civil society leader, she will be moderating today's session on reimagining education for equitable, democratic, and inclusive society. Over to you, Annie ma'am.
Thank you, Maju. It's really a privilege to be part of this conversation. A privilege to be having this time with Professor Govinda, Amrish, and Aishe, three very different dimensions of the education sector. I think first of all, I would really like to congratulate all the organizations that have come together to do this reimagining series, because I think it's really a time when we are floundering as to how we move forward. And this collective conversation is something that can really steer us to some directions. And this is really very, very central and critical. And as Maju mentioned, I think the organizers have a very clear request or a requirement out of this conversation to clarify and crystallize some of the asks or dimensions that we think are important to promote the right to education in the larger, deeper way that we would like to have. I think it's pandemics as usual is a time opportunity as well as a time of confusion. And we know that during the Constituent Assembly discussions, we had the discussion whether education should be a fundamental right. And the financial constraints was given as the reason for not making it a fundamental right. Now again, we are at a crossroads, rethinking education and trying to see how it should be designed and made accessible to all children of our country. And I think that is really the call of this time. And I hope this conversation can really lead us towards discussing those dimensions. I wouldn't want to go too much into taking much time, but I think when we look at education and the way that we need to reimagine it, as Maju already mentioned, the distance or the disconnect between the ordinary children of this country and the planners and the administrators is clear in the way that strategies are built of digitalization, of privatization. So I think these are issues which are so distant from children that are the most marginalized communities, the large majority of our children. So it's really very clear that the disconnect between children from these communities and the administration is clearly evident in the strategies that are being built. And it is surely a time when we can relook at the strategies from the ground, from many of us who work with these communities, to see how we can move forward to make education real and something relevant to the country and to the people. We have a very eminent panel, Professor Govinda, who has worked for many, many years in the education sector, particularly school education. We all know him as a teacher. Once I had a program with him and I requested him to speak for a short while and he said, I am a teacher. You can't expect me to talk for small times. I have to talk. And I know the passion that he brings to the work that he does. But we also, more beyond a teacher, we know him as an able administrator of NUPA, fellowship holder of various important fellowships, visiting professors for so many places. I don't think I can sort of really cover his biography in such a short time, but really nice to have you, Professor, and to be able to think through with us from your experience, like what are the dimensions that we can look at this particular point in time in making education real to children of this country. We also have Aishe of the current generation, who is actually, experiencing the kind of traumas that the education system is going through. And extremely proud to have you at this time from JNU being its student leader and the the place that JNU has in all our hearts in promoting not just education, but actually education, democratic values, and so many other dimensions. So your experience and your thoughts will be very valuable, Aisha, and I look forward to having you with us on this discussion. Amrish is an old friend, a campaign activist, advocacy person, someone that has sort of been, I think, in the education campaign for the last so many years. His constant concern of making education something that is accessible to every child, being equal for all children, I think that's been his passion, and he would bring the add value of the current system and its impact on children in different states. So I really look forward to Amrish. He also, very briefly before we start, I think when we reimagine, maybe there are a few dimensions which we can think of. What are the dimensions that we want when we speak of reimagining education? As the organizers already put in place, education and schooling is not just a learning space, but a social space, a democratic space, a space that look into children's health and well-being. So school in our system has been much more than just a learning center. It's been a place where children build friendships, fraternity, engage with each other, and so many other things that can build a community. So I think given that, some of the dimensions maybe that we would like to look at is what is the kind of public investment that we are looking in education? What is the level of governance that we want? We know we have governance at various levels for the schools, from the local to the central level. So at what level should what governance be working? How close should it be to the ground? And what are decisions that need to be taken at different layers and levels? And I think we already know concerns about technology in education, technology through education. How do we make technology as something that we will use for the growth and development of children, and not simply just to dish out some lessons and informations to them and make them, you know, quiet through the day? And I think various other dimensions, I hope we can come up with certain asks clearly that will point to an advocacy strategy, a framework strategy for us as we reimagine a society through education and we reimagine education itself in a society that we want. With this very brief introduction, our order of speakers would be, I would request Professor Govinda to start with, and then request Aisha to come in, and then Amrish ji. At the end of, we would have about 15 to 20 minutes for each speaker. After that, we would open it up for conversations. I would sort of think that we should not be getting into too many questions unless we want to clarify something, but it should be something that we can take the conversation forward to come to clear ways of a framework and a strategy and a few asks that we would like the government to put in place as we are reimagining, and maybe we would have a post-COVID society that is very different from the pre-COVID society that we have known. So over to the panelists. Thank you so much for being here. Request Professor Govinda to initiate the conversation.
Thank you. And thanks for the organizers for inviting me to share some of my points. Since I am the first speaker, let me begin by looking at the issue in a little broader perspective, the broader canvas, and then come to the issue of RTE. RTE, I have a very emotional attachment to RTE, having been a part of the drafting of the RTE at various stages, beginning from 2005 to 2009 as it came. But I will not really take too much time telling about my own experience. Let me begin by the issue that is before us about the pandemic and its implications, what is happening. I would say that, you know, the pandemic is not just in India, as we know, the whole world actually, for the first time we find that it's a worldwide disruption of schooling that is happening. And UNESCO and UNICEF are pointing out that millions of children are out of school across the world. But I would say this broad description does not really point to the real issue. Why so many children are out of school? What is bothering us in the whole process? Actually, in my view, that children have to be kept out of education because they cannot go to school is essentially points to the failure of what we have adopted as our model of high modernity and industrial capitalism, which has actually believed in standardized framework being created for the school, a rigid framework for education that has come to occupy our society, the civilization as a whole. And when we are stuck with a crisis of this kind, we are exposed. It is exposing our inability to imagine alternative means of educating our children. If the school is not there, education is not there. Almost it has come to that. This is the condition to which we have pushed ourselves because of the kind of model that we have pursued in building our own civilization. But let us not mistake, you know, although this is a worldwide phenomenon, not everybody gets affected the same way. The developed world, it will pass. In the developed world, this will pass. Maybe the college students will graduate 1 year later than what is happening. And maybe the children, instead of 5-year-old children, 6-year-old children, maybe they will be 7-year-old when they begin their schooling. That's all that may happen. But very soon the world will return to its normal, because 100 years ago also a similar pandemic had happened, but we returned. So the real issue is not about delivering lessons to the children as we are attempting through the technology and other means. The real issue of what pandemic has done to the world is deepening of the poverty and inequality, which is the real issue. In fact, what it has led to closer to us is the displacement, unemployment, disruption in social life. And what is the impact of this is that it is going to push larger number of children across the world out of school for a much longer period than what we are thinking. And the poorer the people are the worst hit, not just in India, across the world they are going to be hit. And there are many stories that are already coming up in various parts of the world, how this has led to increase in child abuse, violence against children, child trafficking, and many other things that are happening. The girls will be the worst affected and the worst victims of this unfolding phenomenon across the world. Now, this is a larger phenomenon that is happening in the world. But what is happening to Indian school education? Indian school education scene is doubly complex in my view. And I would say it is a disaster waiting on the wings, waiting to happen anytime. We have not realized, because education in India was already in a crisis stage. And only the pandemic has really pushed us face to face in realizing that we are in a crisis stage. Why I'm saying that is that since we are talking about RTE and bringing all children to school, let us recognize that there were already millions of children who are never getting enrolled in this country. And there are many more millions, particularly girls, who are dropping out without completing even 5 years of primary schooling. This number is not small. Official reports tell that about 20 to 25% children out of 20 crores that we are talking. Imagine the number that we are talking, who are dropping out without completing even 5 years of schooling. What is going to happen with the pandemic is that both these categories are going to increase multifold. There will be increased multifold. There will be many, many more millions of children who are likely not to enroll themselves, stay outside the school framework, and many more millions of children who are going to school who are likely to drop out. That is the kind of situation. How do we ensure that they get their right to education? That is the question that we are facing if this is going to happen. This is on the demand side in terms of what is happening, how many more children are likely to fall out of the school framework. What is the ground reality in terms of the schools that we have to really meet this emerging crisis? If you look at the supply side situation, it is even more frightening, because we have condemned a very large section of the population in this country to the bottom in such a way that around 35% of the schools are barely schools, and most of the children who are being further pushed into this pandemic situation out of the school, they are all actually belonging to this category of 35% of the schools. And we keep telling, since we are talking about imagining a new world, I should say, you know, we never stop saying that education is the ladder through which mobility will happen. People will be able to rise up in social and economic hierarchy. We keep telling this, but can a crumbling infrastructure of the kind that we have created in this country, where even the RTE, which set the very basic minimum that is required, and we know that only around 12% of the schools in this country satisfy all the requirements, and maybe around 35% of the schools do not satisfy even the basic two or three requirements that is including the teacher requirement in the schools. Now, how do we really ensure that the children will all get education in such a situation? That is what prevailed. How do we keep talking about in the constitutional commitment of equality and justice and everything, but is a situation of this kind really provide us an equitable system of schooling for all children? This is where we have been. Now this situation is going to worsen with the COVID that is unfolding. The school infrastructure that has been created, which is already in a very dilapidated condition in many places, you will find that they are uncared for many months and are being utilized for alternate purposes, not for schooling. Now, when the one day government will announce that the schools will reopen, the teachers should go back to school. When they go back to school, and when children, if they go back to school, they will realize that the school is in worse condition than what it was earlier. And this is a serious issue that is going to happen in the next few months when the schools begin reopening. And will the government really invest in improving it? I am not very sure. The government will quote the financial stringency. Government has already announced that there will be no new scheme for the next 1 year, which means that there will be no new money that will be available for education. And we are already investing very meager amount in education. And this is going to further dry up. So the school infrastructure will be crumbling infrastructure, within which we will face a serious situation. What will happen to the displaced children who are going back to villages? They will have to face a crowded classroom, maybe a situation where there are no schools at all. This is one part of the story. Second issue of the supply side problem that we are facing is of the teachers. We know that we already had a very serious shortage of teachers. And if you use the word qualified teachers, it is even bigger a shortage of teachers that we are facing. Now, this number of shortage of teachers will go up, because for the last several months, we have not been replacing the teachers who are retiring. And there is no likelihood that in the next 1 year, we will recruit any teacher, because there will be, in all probability, all the state governments are going to impose a freeze on further recruitment. And therefore, this impact of this non-availability of teachers and non-recruitment of teachers is going to be multifold. And worst affected, again, will be the marginalized children who are attending schools in the bottom of the pyramid. What will happen? Number one, there will be no proper teaching in the schools at the bottom. There will be increased failure and dropout, which is already happening, which number is going to increase. Second, there will be more private substandard schools that will mushroom, which will trap the parents, poor parents, and further impoverish them. Third, the government is likely to remain indifferent, if not openly support such privatization moves, which they are already supporting in more than one ways. Fourth, there will be some sort of a replacement for teachers through technological solutions like WhatsApp. I heard that WhatsApp is also being used apart from Zoom and many others that are being used. And as though they will solve the problem, the virtual world will replace the real world, we think, which is an illusion that we are likely to create. You may tell me that, you know, will there be no philanthropic support for overcoming this problem? Yes, philanthropy may come forward, but we know, as we saw when the migrant laborers were to go back, what we found is the philanthropic support will come only in a very marginal sense. The real issue will have to be dealt with through the government. And government, we need to compel the government to really act upon this. So let me take the last two points in terms of where do we go from here? How do we reduce the misery of the poor and the displaced and ensure that they do get, the poor and marginalized also get some education that is meaningful? I would deal with in terms of the short-term solution, and since we are saying that we are imagining a different world, that I will also come give my idea in terms of the long-term solution. The short-term solution, I should say that there is no pan-Indian solution. There is no pan-Indian. This idea, one India, one strategy, is not going to work. Not even one state and one strategy is likely to work. We need to search for decentralization. We need to search for finding local solutions which are community-centered. I think we need to return to the community in order to really reach education to the marginalized groups. I don't think that the school as we have conceived is going to really do everything. We should not hesitate in this move to adopt temporary alternatives or supplementary action which are outside the formal schools. That's what I feel many NGOs will have to come forward for this. We have to, our focus will have to be to retain those who have been in the school system and bringing those who are falling out of the school system back to the fold of the schooling, which requires more non-formal channels. We know, like the camps for the children have really, the short-term camps can really help in mainstreaming the children back. We need to adopt a number of creative methods of at the local level to mainstreaming the children. What is required, therefore, is local activism, not just a standard solution. Local activists, local people who can champion the cause of the people, identifying, mapping out the localities where large number of children who have gone back and who do not have a school to attend to, find alternate solutions for them. How do we really do it? The large scale model is not likely to work. We need to look for what they would say is the let 1,000 efforts take shape, and then don't try to really replicate, because they have to take local shape. In my view, that is where the short-term solution lies, that we need to map out and then reach out to small localities and think of this. I will end by saying that, you know, is there a long-term solution? As we recover, can we really make the government to adopt a longer solution? So that such a situation that we are facing will not arise. Yes, the longer solution would require a deeper engagement to bring about some structural reforms. The structural reforms that should address the issue of inequality within the school system. Recently, the Human Development Report pointed out that with education system, intra-school variability, that is the inequality within the education system, is one of the highest in India. And that is bringing down significantly the Human Development Index of India also. That is what the Human Development Report said. So what we have done, why I'm saying this, is that over the years, during the last 70 years, we have created a schooling framework which is basically discriminatory, which segregates children, not bring children together, but which segregates children based on their origin and wealth. And this is something that is affecting us. Today we are seeing it face to face, when some children, when we say only 26% children has access to any kind of technological platform, and we are coming face to face to really. But for 70 years, we have actually promoted and built a school system which is segregatory and discriminatory in nature. And today, what we have are schools are more like ghettos. That we have schools for the ultra rich, separate schools. We have the schools separately for the not so rich people. And we have separate schools for the middle class. We have separate schools for the aspiring local class, lower class. And we have separate schools for the rest of the marginalized and the scheduled caste, scheduled tribes, remote localities, which nobody bothers about. So these are all parallel streams, parallel paths of learning. And many paths of learning actually are truncated. They never go beyond a particular level. And only some of them really reach to a higher level. This kind of a multiple paths of learning, which are discriminatory, need to change. The lower the pecking order, harder it is for to move up the path. This is the kind of paths of learning path that we have created for this. We have to, what is required, we have to create common pathways for learning. Common pathways which are wide, which are inclusive, where children without distinction and discrimination sit together and learn together. I think this is the biggest need today in India. This is the only way we can really only when we learn together that we will also learn to live together in harmony, which indeed is the real requirement in the present day India. That is what I think we need to really go ahead and then do. This is what I wanted to share with you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor, for an extremely crisp and practical, an ideated way of sharing your thoughts. I think you have rightly placed before us the kind of schooling that reflects our society rather than the kind of schooling we want to change our society and the issues behind it. And also for giving us some very practical thoughts on short-term and long-term strategies to move forward. What I really picked up is also that whole deep concern about the type of society we are creating out of this whole system. And how do we look at a larger picture than just education infrastructure and investment in education and certain known pathways of teaching and learning. Particularly, I think many of us who've been talking about common school system, you've given us a new name saying that common pathways of learning need not, because we keep talking about common school system and all of us understand it differently and take away differently from it. But if we can really look at it as common pathways of learning, maybe differentiated strategies that we will adopt. And I particularly think that the need for contextualizing the system at the local level, at the community level, is extremely valuable and important for us at this point in time. Thank you so much for bringing up these points. And I hope these will be picked up in our discussion forward to come together. I think at one level as civil society, what do we do? And at another level, what is the kind of asks that we can create towards the government? Thank you so much. We'll come back to some of these issues as the conversation moves forward. And I request Aisha to come in and share your thoughts, Aisha.
Yeah. I hope I'm audible.
Yes. Can you just adjust your video a little bit so that we can see you a little more? Yeah.
Yeah. So, first of all, thank you for having me in the panel. Whoever the speaker is, along with me, they are much experienced in this field. I have been a student in Delhi University doing my bachelor's, now doing my MA and MPhil in JNU. And the approach I will be taking towards is more student on the receiving end, that how students, we perceive what is happening with the education system and how in these last so many years that we have been exposed to education, how what we see as the fault lines present in this COVID period and obviously how do we see the future. Now, as I will start with how sir said that local, when he's saying that ki local, we should be starting with the addressing the issues in local. I feel that one thing that also we need to understand that the government has to be like understanding what the real meaning of education has to be, because it has to be both ways. Once we have the local solutions, we also have to expect that the administrations above us making the larger policies need to first understand that what are they feeling or going to give it to the future generations. That is very much important, because unless and until we have that, it becomes very difficult also to just solve things locally or to have resources at local levels or try to solve each issues. Now we know that as whatever data is there in this whole period of pandemic, lakhs of students have been affected worldwide. In India, the situation is coming out worse, because we know already the pre-existing divide that was there. As sir has correctly pointed out, that there has been ghettoization in education, that people who have coming from certain class, who have money or are in certain economic background, they will be going to particular schools, and those who don't, they will be opting out for certain particular educational institutions. And at the end of the day, the students who come from both marginalized section and economically marginalized section, they will be left out either to choose on their own that whether they want to opt education or not. And I feel then how the new education policy also is going to impact, because we can't see this whatever, obviously the pandemic is there, the situation is very special, but what is going to happen after this is also is not in isolation of what the policies the government is continuously taking. Now the thing is, a government at this present moment, I'm not saying that the crisis is just has created in the past couple of 2-3 years, but this is a long crisis that has not been addressed to. That what do we want to do with the education system? Are we going to create machines out of students who will do job and who will be earning and just be more mechanical? Or are we educating students also to contribute towards the society, which also includes that a student obviously having education then through their job contributing to the society. Are our education more humanitarian in form, that we do understand and solve the problems within our society? Because whatever, as a student, I feel that whatever courses we learn, whether it's we are studying sciences, we are studying social sciences, everything is rooted back into the society. Everything as education as we receive, we can contribute back to the society. We can contribute back to the society for making our society more inclusive. But that aspect has not been much encouraged, what we see in our society. That like I especially is a student of international relations, but how many young students of international relations from government institutions do we see is been encouraged in policy making or giving giving their like note about policy making? We don't. And that is why what I see as an important part at this moment is, first of all, the effort should be of more public funded educational institutions. Now how the NEP, like the new education policy 2019 draft, has been talking about that philanthropists can be there can be philanthropists who are helping out educational institutions. Now, the problem with these kind of education institution is that obviously people will not as per see it as privatization as of education. Because we have had a lot of debates regarding this, and people have said that, okay, if somebody wants to contribute and help in mitigating literacy rate, and they want to increasing literacy rate in local areas, what is the issue? The issue is that it is going to bifurcate and create more larger ghettoization of education system and formalize the divide, whether it's based on caste lines, whether it's based on gender lines, whether it's based on lines of other factors like religion and all, it wherever the source is coming from, that person's biasness is going to affect it at the ground. But we don't expect that from the government. What we expect from the government is a government will be a more will be at the end where it provides education to all for all in more equitable approach, where in a school you don't have any kind of ghettoization on the basis of caste, on the basis of gender, where the administration understands that what is the issue being a woman to come into education. So my understanding is that this has to be a collaboration. The government having the participation of policymakers, and also as student, I have always felt the participation of student representatives is very, very much important. And there is where I feel that unless and until, like we see at this moment, is this in this juncture of pandemic, that how the government sitting is deciding that, or whoever is, I don't know who is giving them the thought that digital reformation within this pandemic will be a huge success, but they are utterly failing in it. And we have seen how the government doesn't want to listen to students, that what actually are they facing in this whole pandemic. There are students who are going through immense mental trauma. There are students who are going through huge socioeconomic issues. Like a lot of women came out of their families to go for education because they got the support of midday meal, because they got the support of fellowships. During this pandemic, midday meal, fellowship, everything is closed down. So for girls to they maybe don't have proper facilities back at their home. Their homes don't have spaces for them to accommodate their educational space or something. And we see that we have seen contrary, a government which doesn't even want to leave alone making policies first, doesn't even want to address these issues. And I feel that the more we run away from accepting that these are the fault lines and then go for policy, we are not going to improve. And that is exactly the problem, that till date we have not been able to improve our educational system because we have not accepted the issues. We have not accepted that, yes, our educational institutions have not been able to address the issues of the women, the issues of the students coming from the marginalized section. We have not been able to first accept. And unless and until we accept that, we won't find policies to now change that. Now, exactly the same problem is happening at this moment. During this pandemic, we see that the government, if you see the statement of the education minister when he was giving an interview to BBC, Hindi. And I clearly remember when I heard that, and he's saying, students online kar lenge. Students will go for online evaluation. Humne students ko bata diya hai. Like the way he approaches is that every student has a laptop. He's the way he approaches, if anybody, an outsider hears, will think, okay, Indian students have laptops, Indian students have internet facilities free of cost and everything. The issue is, unless and until our ministers, our policymakers accept first for the fact that there is a digital divide. Internet penetration rate in the whole country isn't at average of 40%, with Delhi being one of the union territories which has the highest. And if you see the other places, it's quite low. It's like somewhere it's 18%, somewhere it's 20%. Now the question is, pre-pandemic, we have seen that even when there was a classroom teaching, a formal classroom teaching, we have seen immense reports where we have seen in many of the states, students are not able to go to school during the times of monsoon because their schools are flooded with water, or their schools are at some area where they are having to walk for 10 kilometers every day because they can't.
Can I just request you to wind up maybe in another 2-3 minutes?
Yeah. The thing is, the students have been told to walk for kilometers and then reach school. And many of the women have, that's why, opted out to drop out, because the kind of harassments outside they have got, inside the kind of violence that they are facing. So my understanding of this whole thing is, the pandemic is already putting a lot of pressure. and how this pandemic has also brought out that public funding in healthcare is important. And that is why at the same time, if we don't understand that healthcare and education, especially education, how can change students, like people's life, if we don't have that approach towards more socially formulating the policies, I don't think so more technologically, or we improve it even technologically by saying that, okay, we have given smart classes to particular schools. We are not going to address the issues, the social and economic issues, inequalities at immediate goal. Thank you.
Shay, I think from your location as a student and a student leader, you have really highlighted some of the very very critical points that we need to consider as we are planning to move forward. And I think particularly the whole dimension of the government not being able to hear and acknowledge the contextual reality is one huge area. I think the government is living in its own idea of where the country is and thinking where the people of this country is, and that we are seeing in this pandemic again and again. And I think that's really a huge challenge that we have. And secondly, also that there is a paternalistic and a philanthropical attitude rather than a collaborative and an equalitarian attitude. So we are expecting private and philanthropy to really create an equal society, which is not the means to the end that we are talking about. And I think as a student and a student leader, you must really be sort of facing and understanding these much more critically. And I think as student leaders, you've also shown very clearly that you have perspectives, you have points of view, you have solutions, and these need to be discussed. And I think with different parts of our society, the governance system has to really meet it in a contextual manner to understand these things. Surely the discussion will take forward some of these issues, and thank you for the thoughts that you have placed before all of us. Amrishji, can I request you to come and share your thinking on how do we reimagine society and education?
सबसे पहले तो मैं organizers को धन्यवाद दूंगा, because they have bring the very, very, very relevant topic, reimagining education for equitable, democratic, and just society, inclusive society. So, पहले तो इसके लिए मैं बहुत-बहुत धन्यवाद दूंगा और माजू और प्रिया को कि उन्होंने इस डिस्कशन में पार्टिसिपेट करने का मुझे मौका दिया. दिस और मैं समझता हूँ कि एजुकेशन का जो व्हाई वी आर गोइंग टू रीइमेजिन एजुकेशन इन दिस क्राइसिस पीरियड, बिकॉज वी फॉरगेटिंग द लार्जर ऑब्जेक्टिव ऑफ एजुकेशन. एक्चुअली ये लंबे समय से हम इस डिस्कोर्स से बाहर होते जा रहे हैं. Our whole educational discourse was immersed through the anti-caste struggle and anti-colonial struggle. Brahmanwad ke khilaf ladte hue hamare Bharat ne education ka discourse develop kiya, ya fir samrajwad ke khilaf sangharsh karte hue humne apne education discourse ko develop kiya. And then we described that hamara jo education hai wo that is for building an egalitarian society, that is for building a just society. ये जो और इसलिए हम education की जब भी बात करते हैं तो हम constitutional values, principles की भी बात करते हैं. We want to see that constitutional and values should be incorporated in the textbook and the curriculum and all these things. तो इसलिए वो जो discourse है हमारे देश में, जो महात्मा फूले से शुरू हुआ, सावित्री बाई फूले से शुरू हुआ, फातिमा शेख से शुरू हुआ, प्री इंडिपेंडेंट स्ट्रगल पीरियड में दादा भाई नौरोजी, गोपाल कृष्ण गोखले, एंड आफ्टर दैट महात्मा गांधी की नई तालीम, रविंद्रनाथ टैगोर का शांति निकेतन, बाबा साहब अंबेडकर का कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन के समय जो डिस्कशन और डिबेट अराउंड द एजुकेशन था, मौलाना आजाद, सर सैयद अहमद, जाकिर हुसैन, ये जो बड़ा रिच डिस्कोर्स रहा है शिक्षा, शिक्षा फॉर व्हाट पर्पज, क्या उसका पर्पज है, ये धीरे 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 खत्म होता चला जा रहा है. एंड नाउ वी आर जस्ट कन्फाइनिंग आवर सेल्स दैट एजुकेट, द पर्पज ऑफ एजुकेशन इज एजुकेट नॉट ए बिल्ड इन सोसाइटी बट टू सर्व मार्केट फोर्सेज. दैट इज द नाउ वी हैव रीच्ड एट दिस एक्सटेंट. और ये जो प्रमोट, ये हमारी सरकारें भी इसको प्रमोट कर रही हैं लगातार कि शिक्षा जो है वो मार्केट के लिए टेक्नोक्रेट्स पैदा करे, प्रोफेशनल्स पैदा करे, मार्केट की सेवा में वो ज़्यादा से ज़्यादा स्किल वर्कर्स पैदा करे. एंड दैट इज होल द पर्पज ऑफ एजुकेशन इज लिमिटेड. तो इसलिए मुझे, मैं समझता हूँ कि ये बहुत ही महत्वपूर्ण बहस आपने शुरू की है और इसको चलाया जाना चाहिए कि एजुकेशन का जो लार्जर ऑब्जेक्टिव है वो कहाँ है, कि कहाँ चला गया लार्जर ऑब्जेक्टिव. वट एवर यू सेलेक्ट द मोड एंड यू, इफ यू आर सेलेक्टिंग द मोड फॉर डिपार्टिंग फॉर द प्रोवाइडिंग एजुकेशन टू द चिल्ड्रेन एंड दैट इज एक्चुअली डिराइव फ्रॉम योर ऑब्जेक्टिव. आपका अगर ऑब्जेक्टिव है टू बिल्ड ए इक्विटेबल डेमोक्रेटिक एंड जस्ट सोसाइटी, इंक्लूसिव सोसाइटी, तो आप उस तरह के इंस्ट्रूमेंट, उस तरह का मोड ऑफ टीचिंग लर्निंग प्रोसेसेस चुनेंगे. और इसलिए मैं इसलिए इस बात को उठाना चाहता हूँ कि दिस पेंडेमिक हैज एक्सपोज्ड आवर द लिमिटेशन ऑफ आवर सिस्टम एट एवरी लेवल, एट एवरी फ्रंट, and forced us to rethink our developmental paradigm. Our rethink, हमने जो भारत में विकास का किया है वो कैसा विकास है, किन के लिए विकास है, और चाहे वो हेल्थ हो, एजुकेशन हो, इकोनॉमिक सिस्टम हो हमारा, डेमोक्रेसी हो, इवन पोलिटिकल सिस्टम, वेयर वी रीच, वी आर लुकिंग जस्ट, वी आर विटनेसिंग सच ए पोलिटिकल सिस्टम विच इज वेरी सेंट्रलाइज, autocratic, very, very repressive, and we are divisive, such type of political system we are facing. And that is the outcome of the whole development paradigm which we had in the past. So, isliye abhi us sab par sochne ki zarurat hai. And we can't see education in isolation. Education is the part of this socio-economic system, socio-economic political system. So if you are rethinking about the education and the we are redesigning the whole our education system, then we have to look at the nature of the state, we have to look at the economic system, social system and political system itself. So if you are not doing this, we are not connecting education with our socio-economic path, so a paradigm, a development paradigm, it means we are just bringing education as a like ये कोई हेल्थ का स्कीम या कोई सड़क बनाने की परियोजना या कोई इस तरह की बात है नहीं. कोठारी साहब ने सही कहा था, डेस्टिनी ऑफ द नेशन इज जस्ट प्रिपेयरिंग, कंस्ट्रक्टिंग इन क्लासरूम. तो इसलिए उसके साथ जोड़ के हमको देखना चाहिए. तो एक तो ये मैं कहना चाहता हूँ कि इस पेंडेमिक ने जरूर सब चीजों को एक्सपोज कर दिया है कि हमारा जो एजुकेशन सिस्टम है वो एक्चुअली वी आर हैविंग ए हाईली अनइक्वल एजुकेशन सिस्टम इन कंपैरिजन टू अदर कंट्रीज. इतना अनइक्वल एजुकेशन सिस्टम, यू कैन इमेजिन, वी हैव नॉट ओनली पब्लिक एंड प्राइवेट एजुकेशन सिस्टम, विद इन द पब्लिक सिस्टम वी हैव सो मेनी लेयर्स, केंद्रीय विद्यालय, नवोदय विद्यालय, प्रतिभा विद्यालय, सैनिक स्कूल, एंड दे आर फंडेड मोर देन फ्रॉम द पब्लिक फंड, दे आर फंडेड मोर देन एनी ऑर्डिनरी गवर्नमेंट स्कूल्स. एंड दैट्स व्हाई दिस केंद्रीय विद्यालय इज गुड परफॉर्मिंग स्कूल. एंड इफ यू आर ब्रिंगिंग ऑल द, इफ यू कैन ब्रिंग ऑल द स्कूल्स एट द लेवल ऑफ केंद्रीय विद्यालय, ऑल स्कूल्स कैन बी क्वालिटी स्कूल्स. So that's why second thing I want to say that we need to bring education, we need to link education with our whole social economic development, economic structure. तीसरी बात जो मैं कहना चाहता हूँ वो ये कि इस pandemic में कुछ बात you know that data is available that all schools are closed out. We have, and children are out of school. We have right to Education Act. Education is a fundamental right in our country since 2002. And for this fundamental right, for the realization of this fundamental right, we have Right to Education Act in place. And after 10 years, we have to rethink this also. After 10 years, out of 1.5 million schools, only 12.7% schools are RTE compliant. Why? Why government, why state is not willing to implement their own law, which is enacted by the parliament with the consensus of the all political parties from the parliament? And because of this act has to universalize the school education. तो ये सोचना है कि ये 10 साल हो गए, 100 साल के संघर्ष के बाद हमने 2002 में मौलिक शिक्षा को मौलिक अधिकारों के साथ जोड़ा, और दैट मौलिक अधिकार इज नॉट ए सिंपल अधिकार, इट इज पार्ट ऑफ द लाइफ, राइट टू लाइफ. आर्टिकल 21 के साथ राइट टू एजुकेशन जुड़ा है. तो वी हैव एक्सक्लूडेड द बिलो 6 मिलियंस ऑफ चिल्ड्रन बिलो 6 एंड सेकेंडरी एजुकेशन फ्रॉम द परव्यू ऑफ द आरटी एक्ट. फिर भी ये जो एलिमेंट्री एजुकेशन का साइकिल है, ये फंडामेंटल राइट के साथ जुड़ा है, और इसको लागू करने में जो टाइमलाइन थी वो खत्म हो गई, और 10 साल बाद हम केवल 12.7% स्कूल्स में हम इस कानून को लागू कर पाए. और रिसोर्सेज, कोठारी साहब, यू नो द फर्स्ट एजुकेशन कमीशन लेड बाय कोठारी एंड रिनाउंड गांधीयन जेपी नायक, they recommended common school system. And the common school system is not a simple system. It's based on the neighborhood school. And neighborhood, when I'm talking about neighborhood is, it means not a ghettoization. Neighborhood means diversity should be reflected in the school. And that neighborhood, that type of neighborhood we have to construct. And wahan par sare bacche kisi bhi economic status ke ho, kisi bhi कास्ट के हो, किसी भी रिलीजन को है, दे हैव टू कम ओवर देयर. एंड बिकॉज स्कूल इज द प्लेस फॉर सोशलाइजेशन, दैट इज कोठारी हैड सेड, स्कूल जो है सोशलाइजेशन की जगह है. एंड इफ यू आर स्कूल कैन प्ले ए वेरी वाइटल रोल टू मेक टू ब्रिंग इंटीग्रेशन इन द कंट्री. ये एज ए इंस्ट्रूमेंट स्कूल कैन प्ले ए रोल. तो इसलिए ये जो स्कूल का एक जो पूरा था कि सोशलाइजेशन की जगह है कॉमन स्कूल सिस्टम, और उस समय कहा था उन्होंने कि 6% जीडीपी का हम शिक्षा पे खर्च करेंगे. नाउ वी आर स्पेंडिंग ओनली लेस देन 3% ऑन एजुकेशन. तो इसलिए मैं इस बात को उठाना चाहता हूँ कि कानून फंडामेंटल राइट बना, कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनल ऑब्लिगेशन है, कानून बना, और कानून के 10 साल हो गए, फिर भी सरकार अपने कानूनों को लागू नहीं करती है, उसके लिए एडिक्वेट रिसोर्सेज नहीं देती है. वैकेंस 9 लाख टीचर पोस्ट और वैकेंट, यू नो, एट द एलिमेंट्री लेवल. क्यों ऐसा है? क्यों सरकारें अपने ही बनाए हुए कानूनों को पालन नहीं करती है? इसका मतलब कि पब्लिक प्रेशर से जो कानून बन जाते हैं, सरकार का उसके प्रति कमिटमेंट नहीं है. वी हैव टू थिंक अबाउट दैट ऑल्सो, वाई दे आर नॉट इम्प्लीमेंटिंग. We are submitting the memorandums, demands, and all these things. And government is sometimes under the pressure, they are implemented something, but they are not implementing. Implementation is very big challenge in our country. So, एक तो ये है कि why implementation नहीं हुआ, एक fundamental right, एक कानून होने के बावजूद भी, और अब जो और इसलिए अगर जो policy भी बन रही है, the national education policy, they are saying that it should be extended from 3 to 18 years. Lekin now, after this crisis, we are recommending the digital education. Can you imagine why we are not considering the whole path, whole planning under the garb of, under this fundamental right and right to education? When education is a fundamental right, when we have a law, so at the time of building, preparing a planning for the continuation of education, we have to keep in mind that education is a fundamental right. No children, every child has right to enjoy this fundamental right and right to education. तो अभी जो डिजिटलाइजेशन की आपको मालूम है कि हमारे जेएनयू के साथी ने यह बात उठाई कि इस पूरे क्राइसिस के पीरियड में चिल्ड्रन आर दे हैव नो एक्सेस टू फूड, दे आर सफरिंग विद द एक्यूट इशू प्रॉब्लम्स, दे हैव नो साइको सोशल सपोर्ट एंड देयर इज अ रिपोर्ट दैट चाइल्ड मैरिज इज हैपनिंग, चाइल्ड लेबर, यू नो चाइल्ड लेबर, बहुत सारे परिवार के लोग अपने बच्चों को अब रैक पिकिंग पर भेज रहे हैं बिकॉज दिस पेंडेमिक हैज आल्सो एक्सपोज आवर अप्रोच ऑफ द स्टेट टुवर्ड्स इट्स सिटीजंस, स्पेशली वर्किंग मासेज, स्पेशली माइग्रेंट. वी आर विटनेसिंग दैट हाउ माइग्रेंट्स हैव रिटर्न टू देयर नेटिव प्लेसेस आफ्टर द लॉकडाउन. तो आप समझ सकते हैं कि ये कितना बड़ा क्राइसिस रहा कि जो लोग लौटे हैं वापस वो बड़ी तादाद में बहुत मुश्किलों में, और शायद पार्टीशन की यादें लोगों को ताजा हो गई, तो वो जो लौटे हैं उनके साथ बच्चे भी लौटे हैं. और हरियाणा और पंजाब की रिपोर्ट आ रही है कि लो कॉस्ट प्राइवेट स्कूल में, जैसा गोविंदा साहब ने कहा कि बहुत सारे हमारे पास बहुत तरह के स्कूल हैं, प्राइवेट स्कूल है, लो कॉस्ट प्राइवेट स्कूल इज मशरूमिंग, गवर्नमेंट स्कूल है, स्पेशल कैटेगरी गवर्नमेंट स्कूल्स हैं, ये सारे हमारे पास है. तो वो लो बजट स्कूल्स में अब पेरेंट्स की नौकरी चली गई, 12 करोड़ लोगों के जॉब्स चले गए, उनके बच्चे जो वहां पढ़ते थे वो वापस सरकारी स्कूलों में आने वाले हैं. तो सरकारी स्कूल इसके लिए तैयार हैं, ये एक बहुत बड़ा सवाल है, बिकॉज वी आर लैकिंग रिसोर्सेज, वी आर लैकिंग टीचर्स, वी आर लैकिंग इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर. कैन यू इमेजिन वी हैव After even after 10 years of the enactment of the RTE Act, we have only 52% schools where we can access drinking water, functional toilet, and wash facilities. Can you imagine? अगर हम reopen करें school को, तो भी आधे schoolों में हमारे पास wash की facility नहीं है, पीने का पानी नहीं है, functional toilet नहीं है, और कैसे हम अपने बच्चों की safety, security की guarantee कर सकते हैं? तो ये जो बड़ा एक बड़े पैमाने पर जो आई एम जस्ट कंक्लूडिंग इन टू मिनट्स दैट दिस डिजिटलाइजेशन इज ए अनदर वे टू प्राइवेटाइज एजुकेशन, इट्स ए टूल फॉर सेग्रीगेशन आल्सो. तो इसलिए डिजिटल एजुकेशन एंड एक्सेस इज ओनली 25% एंड 10.7% पीपुल आर हैविंग लैपटॉप एंड दिस कंप्यूटर. So, अगर 70% लोगों को ये एक्सेस नहीं हो सकता है, तो वाई गवर्नमेंट इज टेकिंग एडवाइस फ्रॉम द टेक कंपनीज एंड दे आर जस्ट बिजी विद द प्रोग्रामिंग. और आपको जान के हैरानी होगी कि एनसीईआरटी जो हमारे लिए एक बड़ा एकेडमिक इंस्टीट्यूशन है, वो रोटरी क्लब के साथ मेमोरेंडम ऑफ अंडरस्टैंडिंग साइन कर रहा है, और टेक्नोलॉजी कंपनीज उसको मदद कर रही है टेक्नोलॉजी प्रोग्राम बनाने के लिए. तो ये एक बहुत बड़ा खतरा हमारे सामने खड़ा हुआ है. तो एक तो इसकी बात मैं करना चाहता हूँ कि ये जो टेक्नोलॉजी वाला है, ये हम टेक्नोलॉजी के विरोधी नहीं है, टेक्नोलॉजी कैन बी ब्रॉट टू सपोर्ट द टीचर्स एंड थिंग्स, बट टेक्नोलॉजी एज ए सब्जेक्ट आप लाइए, टेक्नोलॉजी जो है सपोर्ट के लिए लाइए, बट टेक्नोलॉजी कैन नॉट रिप्लेस द टीचर एंड स्कूल्स, ये एक बात होनी चाहिए. क्योंकि जो एजुकेशन का पर्पज है वो इस डिजिटलाइजेशन से डिफीट होता है. एजुकेशन का पर्पज जो है डायलॉग से सर्व होगा, पीयर लर्निंग से सर्व होगा, कनेक्ट विद द कम्युनिटी से सर्व होगा, और एजुकेशन का पर्पज जो है वो है क्रिटिकल मासेस को बनाने का, सोसाइटी को मोबिलाइज करने का. दैट इज द विद द डिसकनेक्टर टू द सोसाइटी यू कांट सर्व द पर्पज ऑफ एजुकेशन. एक बात. दूसरी बात, मैं एक और जानकारी आपको देना चाहता हूँ कि हाल में गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया ने इस क्राइसिस पीरियड में गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया बहुत सारे एंटी पीपल कदम स्टेप्स उठा रही है. एजुकेशन में अभी उन्होंने $3,000 billion का एक एग्रीमेंट वर्ल्ड बैंक के साथ किया, 25,000 करोड़ मैं हिंदी का एक एग्रीमेंट किया है जो 6 राज्यों में चलेगा, जिसमें केरल भी एक शामिल है, और उसमें भी $500 million का लोन दे रहा है वर्ल्ड बैंक एंड वर्ल्ड बैंक डिजाइनिंग टू होल ऑफ दिस प्रोजेक्ट एंड मॉनिटरिंग होल ऑफ दिस प्रोजेक्ट. कैन यू इमेजिन? और उसमें एक नेशनल फ्रेमवर्क बनेगा, एक नेशनल गाइडलाइन बनेगी फॉर नॉन स्टेट एक्टर, फॉर द एंगेजमेंट ऑफ नॉन स्टेट एक्टर्स. सो नाउ दे आर गोइंग टू हैंड ओवर अवर स्कूल्स इवन इन केरला, वेर इज बढ़िया स्कूल चलते हैं, उनको भी वो नॉन स्टेट एक्टर्स को देने की योजना बना रहे हैं. एंड दिस इज द ह्यूज, दे आर गोइंग टू प्राइवेटाइज द होल एजुकेशन सिस्टम. सो दे आर गोइंग टू थ्रो द रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी इवन आफ्टर, डिस्पाइट ऑफ दिस राइट, फंडामेंटल राइट एंड राइट टू एजुकेशन, द प्राइवेटाइजेशन, गवर्नमेंट इज पुशिंग द होल एजुकेशन सिस्टम टूवर्ड्स द प्राइवेटाइजेशन. और हमने अभी देखा है कि इस पूरे कोरोना क्राइसिस के पीरियड में प्राइवेट हेल्थ और प्राइवेट एजुकेशन को, न तो प्राइवेट हॉस्पिटल्स खड़े हुए लोगों के साथ, न तो प्राइवेट स्कूल ने अपने कमरे जो है वो क्वारंटीन के लिए दिए, जो कुछ हुआ वो सरकारी कर्मचारी, सरकारी डॉक्टर, नर्सें, हॉस्पिटल और स्कूल ही खड़े रहे इस क्राइसिस के पीरियड में, जबकि सरकार इसमें इन्वेस्ट नहीं कर रही है, लगातार उसमें कटौती होती जा रही है और प्राइवेट सेक्टर को प्रमोट करने की कोशिश कर रही है. तो देन इसका मतलब ये है कि हमें जो है, और ये हमें और दुनिया के और देशों में मैं देख रहा हूँ, इवन फ्रांस में लोकल इलेक्शंस में मैक्रोन की पार्टी हार गई, इसलिए हार गई बिकॉज दे प्रमोटेड प्राइवेट सेक्टर इन द एसेंशियल सर्विसेज, हेल्थ एंड एजुकेशन, ऑल दिस थिंग्स, एंड दे आर गोइंग टू रिव्यू दैट. एंड वी आर आफ्टर दैट, इस कोरोना के बाद भी जो हमारे प्रधानमंत्री जी ने जो पैकेज की घोषणा की उसमें 8,000 करोड़ की घोषणा कर दी प्राइवेट सेक्टर को मदद करने के लिए हेल्थ एंड एजुकेशन में. कैन यू इमेजिन वेयर वी आर गोइंग? तो इसलिए ये जो री इमेजिनिंग एजुकेशन फॉर इक्विटेबल एंड डेमोक्रेटिक एंड इंक्लूसिव सोसाइटी, आई थिंक वी नीड टू जस्ट develop this debate among the people, among the masses, and फिर से हमको उन बहसों को उठाना होगा कि शिक्षा जो है वो समाज के लिए है और समाज एक social transformation का tool है और उसके हिसाब से ही पूरे system को design करना चाहिए, इसकी मांग हमें उठानी चाहिए. बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद. Thank you.
Thank you,
Amrish
ji. As usual, your emotions and the kind of dimensions that you bring in terms of the connect between education and society and the need for public education and the government to really take responsibility for education as a public good. I think this is, these are some of the things that you have really brought out. I think at this point in time, there are a few dimensions that have come out from the discussions that we've had with from the presentations. I think I would maybe flag two or three of these, and not necessarily to be answered, but as dimensions that we need to think about. And then I think we, if I have missed out any of the dimensions, I would request the organizers also to bring up those dimensions. Some of the dimensions that have come out is the need for a long-term strategy and a short-term strategy, and to define these very clearly, because this pandemic is going to stay with us for maybe a year, 2 years, and things are not going to come back in the same way as what we can plan now. So do we need a short-term strategy and a long-term strategy? If so, some of the dimensions of short-term strategy have been identified. Some of the dimensions of long-term strategy have been identified. I think that is really one dimension that has emerged from what Professor Govinda was speaking. And another dimension that has also emerged from where Professor Govinda was speaking is the level of governance, decentralization, contextualizing education within the community. Are we equipped enough for that? Do we have the power and authority with these decentralized governance systems? How do we ensure that it still provides inclusive quality learning processes and spaces? And how do we move that forward if we are looking at decentralized ways of teaching and learning for children, how do we move that forward, was also one of the dimensions that have come out. Another dimension that has come out is to really look at education as that larger purpose vehicle of public good, not look at reforms in education and reimagine education in its very narrow dimensions, but really set our objectives as a society, the type of society we want, and then place education as the means or the tool or whatever we want as a vehicle that will carry us towards that education. So then what are the kind of dimensions of a society that we are talking about? That has also been something that has emerged from what both Aishe and Amrishji has highlighted. Another dimension that has come, and in this I think the concern or the knowledge systems, the issues of vulnerable communities and how their needs and knowledge will be brought into the system, and that would be something that when we are looking at the social system that we are talking about. Another dimension that has also emerged is the different stakeholders for education and how do we have a system. We know the government is not really listening to this. We know the government is not really listening to this system or to the other stakeholders. So how do we create a hearing space or a collaborative space for different stakeholders to come together? I think that is also something that has come out as important dimensions. So these are some of the thoughts that I have been, and that has also come up in the chat. If there are any other important things, I would sort of request, the organizers who've been tracking the chat box to also bring up particular issues, and maybe rather than just answering, we can pick up some of these and have a little discussion for about 4 or 5 minutes, and if we are able to come up with a strategy. And I would also like to say that apart from the government is the rest of the stakeholders also. So how do we have a strategy for working together creating some of the spaces and the strategies to address the government? Because at this point in time, we are not in collaboration with the government. It seems to be that we'll have to really address the government, the kind of requirements and needs that we think is important. So also a strategy for us as stakeholders outside the government to bring our voices and the strategies that we think, because there's a lot of good methodologies, strategies, lot of people working on education from the ground and civil society. How do we bring these things would be important. And I think we need to also look at, we have to give up this old frame of let our schools get best and then we'll go to our universities. I think it's a time when we'll have to take the whole of the education system together, both the school level and the higher education level, and look at strategies to think together. So how would you like to move forward? Are there other dimensions? We have at least identified 5-6 dimensions. Are there other dimensions that are missed out? Or do we want to pick up these and really articulate, because we know the issues. So do we agree with the issue? Can we build together a strategy on this? Is there a demand that we can create out of this? That would really be the purpose of this next 45 minutes that we have for discussion, 45, 50 minutes. Then I think, should we sort of bring this whole discussion onto the need for short-term and a long-term strategy? Do we think that's something that we need to articulate at this point in time? If so, can we think a little bit about that?
No, actually, I am of the view that, you know, there are some immediate things that have to be done. That means it's more of really meeting the immediate requirement of the poor and the marginalized who have been left out of the school or pushed out of the school because of the crisis that we are facing and all. And we need to really attend to them immediately, get them back to school or give some kind of education at least for them. But that is only short term. But this is not going to really change much. The COVID will go and then we will go back to the same kind of condition where people are neglected. The marginalized will remain marginalized. So if education also has to look at in terms of a long-term transformation process, if we are not engaging with that, and if we don't draw up an agenda and get all the stakeholders together on that kind of an agenda, I don't think, you know, it's going to solve the problem. There will be another crisis and the same situation will repeat again. I also want to add one small thing to what you said, Ami, that government's indifference is a big issue that many people have pointed out. But what bothers me is that RTE, see, you began by, when you introduced, you began by referring to the colonial period and then the what we did as our constitution. When the constitution was formed, it was Article 45, was not a justiciable one. And as you said, the reason that it was not included as a fundamental right, people argued that there is not enough finances, and it was also argued that there will be litigations all over, and then it will not be possible for the new government to handle. After 50 years, when the parliament amended and then put this into the fundamental right, should we not therefore assume by then the country has realized that they have enough resources? They will not say we don't have money and there are enough capabilities to really handle all these things. It will not happen like this. If that is the case, if parliament took the decision, I don't want to say only the government, the parliament, the political class in this country across the board are indifferent to the RTE. Why after 2002, when did we have a full-fledged discussion for a day on primary education in this country? If you look back in the colonial period, there were days when the whole day was spent on discussing primary education. And whereas here, we in the independent India after 70 years, we don't have any discussion on primary education in the this. If they have, they are only talking about peripheral issues like whether there should be continuous comprehensive evaluation, whether there is no detention, these kind of things they are talking. Why doesn't the political class engage? That is my problem. It is not just the government. Then only I think, you know, we will be able to mobilize the people, stakeholders around a common agenda. We need to set a common agenda for transformation and mobilize the people around that.
Yeah, I think you have set the tone on building many of these agendas together in terms of what kind of a society are we looking at and how does that reflect or how does that get built into the education system or the education drive it. Yeah. So any thoughts from anybody else on how, surely I think the public, the government interest or the parliament's interest, the leadership interest, how do we create an interest or a compulsion on the leadership to really take education, the type of education that we want, that will build our society and put their energy and thought into it? Some thoughts on that. We have seen movements in and around at this time, though it has not been easy for activists and movement people to do that, but we have seen the kind of mobilization that can be done, whether it's CAA, NRC, or something else, or in other countries now with violence against George Floyd. So we have seen movements and we are seeing movements. So is there something that we can, as other stakeholders outside the government, really look at as a strategy for building up that momentum to push the leadership to commit to education, to build in the investment, to think, design the education in a way that it will create our society?
No, I just, can I add one point?
Please.
Actually, I don't think we can, through a divided school system, you can create a united India. It is impossible. As many other speakers have also pointed out, biggest problem is this. I think we need to create a constituency of political class, which really works for this, creating a transformation in the existing school system. And we need to create a stakeholder group among the political class. And because political class, when you create that, can also mobilize the grassroots better. simply NGOs mobilizing the grassroots, it doesn't go beyond a particular point without that political leadership coming. I think we should really work towards that. And unless we do that, there will be no fundamental transformation of this. So crisis will come and go, but we will remain the same way, a discriminated, segregated society.
There is a question on what do we think of the model that the Delhi government has created? Is that something that is orienting us towards a society that we want, or the society that can be built?
And they are doing some work. I think it's good if they are doing some work. Government should do their work. Till now they were not doing, now they are doing their work. Whether it will really bring about a sustainable change, I think it is too early to say. They can pat their back, but I want to keep it suspended judgment. I don't want to really say on that. Because temporary changes that we bring and infusing enthusiasm among the people, it's good. Whatever is happening is good only. But whether it will be sustained change, number one. Number two, what the Delhi government is doing is in the government schools. But the major part of the primary education system in Delhi is with the municipal schools. And it's not happening there. And I think the larger system of the primary education in Delhi is not changing. That I think we need to recognize that also.
I think I would like to bring in both Aishe and Amrish ji on this. I think very correctly the whole, to go beyond just civil society mobilization, but to really work on a political class that will be stakeholders. And I think Amrish ji has taken this up in trying to engage both with the school, with the teachers, and also with some of the parliamentarians. What do you see as a strategy that we can move forward in this, Amrish or Aishe?
I agree with Professor Govinda that this is a crisis period. So we need to look at some short strategy and all this thing. So children cannot be go out from the school system, and because that is a huge big issue to bring children back to the school, especially girls, because enactment of RT Act there was an increase in enrollment and people sending their children to the schools, and that was, and now the discontinuation of the school in this period, within the lockdown period, there is a danger, there is a threat that the discontinuation of the schooling of the children, especially girls and all this. So we need to take the shortcut. But now the time, this is the need of the hour, that we have to review the whole system of education. Because you see, that we have a very rich discourse, we have a very comprehensive recommendations by the first education commission, Kothari Commission, and after that 68 education policy in the influence of the Kothari Commission, 86 policy, 92, and everywhere, you know, all the recommendations made by these policies and the commissions, the centrality of the these reports is the equity in education. So make education equitable. So that was the central theme. But the national education policy, now we are looking and government is trying to bring in this corona period. So they are going to pass it. So you see the common school system is not even mentioned the name of the neighborhood school, name of the common school system. Can you imagine? So every policy have the adarsh aapke ye hai ki bhai, if a school is a place for socialization and every child should come at the same place and learn how to make an integrated country, to wo ek usko wo ek instrument tha jisko inhone khatam kar diya. So aapke paas aur kya rasta hai to make education system equitable? अगर कॉमन स्कूल या नेबरहुड स्कूल कॉन्सेप्ट नहीं है तो फिर व्हाट इज द टूल, व्हाट इज द इंस्ट्रूमेंट टू ब्रिंग इक्विटी इन एजुकेशन। तो एक तो ये मुझे लगता है कि शॉर्टर स्ट्रेटजी बनाते समय हमें लार्जर ऑब्जेक्टिव के साथ उसे रिलेट करना, दिस इज द आई थिंक टाइम। इस समय हमको इस पर बात जरूर करनी चाहिए कि कैसे हम शिक्षा का कनेक्ट जो टूट गया है, डिस्कनेक्ट हो गया है सोसाइटी के साथ, उसको कैसे हम लिंक करें। बिकॉज एजुकेशन इज फॉर द नेशन बिल्डिंग, एजुकेशन इज फॉर द बिल्डिंग जस्ट सोसाइटी एजुकेशन, ये जो हमारा लार्जर ऑब्जेक्टिव है। बिकॉज नाउ क्या हो रहा है कि पूरा एजुकेशन जो है मार्केट ड्रिवन, अभी देखिए आप एजेंसी चेंज हो रही है, टीचर एजेंसी अब नहीं है, एनसीईआरटी एजेंसी नहीं है, एकेडमिक इंस्टीट्यूशंस यूनिवर्सिटी, नाउ एजेंसी इज बिकमिंग डिजिटल कंपनीज, दे आर डिजाइनिंग अवर होल एजुकेशन सिस्टम। सो एजेंसी इज शिफ्टिंग फ्रॉम एंड चाइल्ड इज फ्रॉम लर्नर टू कंज्यूमर, चाइल्ड इज ऑल्सो पोजिशन चेंजिंग द पोजिशन हर पोजिशन, तो वो लर्नर से अब वो कंज्यूमर हो जाएगा, और जो एजेंसी है ज्ञान की नॉलेज की और एजुकेशन को डिजाइन करने के, वो हो जाएगी मुनाफा प्रॉफिट मेकिंग कंपनीज। सो दैट इज द खतरा, दैट इज द डेंजर। इफ दे आर डिजाइनिंग द होल एजुकेशन सिस्टम, इट मींस वी आर डिसकनेक्टिंग आवर सेल्स फ्रॉम कॉन्स्टिट्यूशंस आल्सो, कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनल वैल्यू एंड, और इससे कोई लेना देना नहीं है। तो ये खतरा बढ़ रहा है, एंड दिस इज ड्यू टू द कमर्शियलाइजेशन एंड प्राइवेटाइजेशन वेयर गवर्नमेंट इज पुशिंग इटसेल्फ, और इसलिए अपने रिसोर्सेज खत्म कर रहे हैं, टीचर्स को खत्म कर रहे हैं, ये सारा कुछ खत्म करके प्राइवेट सिस्टम के हाथ में देने की तैयारी हो रही है, और इसलिए वर्ल्ड बैंक का ये जो प्रोजेक्ट है ये भी बहुत खतरनाक है। तो दैट इज आई एम सेइंग दैट वी शुड रिलेट शॉर्ट टर्म स्ट्रेटजी विद द लॉन्ग टर्म ऑब्जेक्टिव, बिकॉज शॉर्ट टर्म स्ट्रेटजी ऑल्सो टू फुलफिल द लॉन्ग टर्म ऑब्जेक्टिव, इफ इट इज नॉट so why we are making it is not about to create an access only, so that is I am saying.
Yeah, thank you Amrishi. I think there are 2-3 questions that have come. If anybody has a question and want to raise it also, you can also please raise your hand and we can have the question raised. One of the questions that has also come up, Aisha, is like, how do we currently, the current student movements that we have, the current role of universities in building the kind of education system, building the kind of society that we have, do you see, or how do you see that strategy into the renewal of the framework of education that we are looking at? Aisha, how does the university and students union, how do you think you could play a role?
I think so. Students' union are a very important thing, but that I wanted also to mention when the last discussions in the discussion period is going on, that we also need to identify that what has been the very important role when we are talking about the political class.
Can you come a little nearer to the mic? Yeah.
Hello. When we were talking about the political class, we should address also that which was the political class all these while talking about. We saw a certain section of the left and the progressive section only talking about the NEP, that how much the NEP is going to harm. But the thing that I want to say, that unionization is very much important. Unionization is something that we have been fighting for. At this moment, in many of the colleges and schools, we are seeing how the government is doing away with students' union. They're just not wanting to hear the students' unions or the student representatives. And that is why, at this moment, it is very important that at grassroots level, we have to continuously put pressure. Like a movement and a protest, we can't do away with it as coming out with an alternative to it. Or we can think of that movements and the understanding at grassroots level, the organized, that we organize students or something that can come as an alternative. And also that a very important point that in JNU we keep reiterating, that are at universities or our schools are an extension of our societies. Like what we are facing at our back at our families, what are we as students, as human beings face is exactly what we that will reflect in the schools, in the policies. And that is why it is very important that the students in the universities, in the colleges keep speaking and reiterating this politics and keep saying continuously that what happening in Kerala today. And when people are talking about 100% literacy rate or talking about Kerala, how they are managing this pandemic with the particular education system is not happening in isolation. There is something behind it. There is a government which thinks in a particular way, which is leading to do that. We are not seeing that same thing happening in other states or in other parts. Why? We are seeing that only certain places are able to cope up. But even after like policymakers are raising, then also we are seeing that certain governments are not able to pick it up. Why is it happening? Because I agree to Amrit sir, where he is saying that the whole education system is being pushed towards a more profit-oriented thing that we are always against. But we in maximum of the university spaces, we keep saying that education is not a material. Education is something that you can't sell it. That you, if you have 1 lakh rupees, you take this degree. It's a gold, platinum, silver kind of marketing value system. Education should be something is we always, when we are talking about right, it should be imparted to all in most equitable basis. And we have to find the loopholes that where is our system not able to approach that. And that is why I want to reiterate that this continuous, there is a, this is a very big policy also the government is using. This individualistic, philanthropic idea of changing the society. I feel it's very good to hear about that. It's a very charming thing to hear for the first go, but that is not going to bring change in the longer run. A sustainable, organized movement along with a particular thinking, a particular politics is only going to change the scenario of education. Because unless and until our governments, our state governments realize, yes, there are caste discrimination or gender-based discriminations happening, I seriously don't think that we will be able to better the situation of women in our states or in any of the regions or at the local level. When we don't even understand that menstrual hygiene is a reality, how do we understand that there will be menstrual hygiene awareness happening in the school level? People will still shy away to talk about it after 70 years. So there is a politics behind it. And and moreover, I think so these days it has been told students should be kept out of politics. Science and politics can't relate. That has led to this era in 2020 when we have gone to such a condition when students are being told that science is not a reality, mythology is. So we need to get our basics straight that what is the politics that we are choosing, what is the politics we are supporting, and that exactly is going to bring a progressive change in the longer run.
I think you've set the issue quite on its quite to the point, Aisha, but I'm just thinking, I'm just also looking at the whole World Bank thing that Amrish ji mentioned, and there was so much of a response and so much of mobilization in this time, and we don't really see our government listening to it or taking a decision in favor of people. So how do we create a political class that can, that can just, really
just
help
a point. The agenda?
Can I say a point on that?
Yes.
Now, I have been part of many of these things, and then I agree that, you know, what Brish has said or what Aisha says, right, about this privatization is killing the system. There is no question about that. I think we all need to fight against that. This World Bank running these 5 states are going to be a very serious issue. We need to fight on that. But when I made this point about creating a political class as stakeholders in this, Amrish knows very well, many times we have attempted to get the parliamentarians to come for discussion, and then we discuss with them. They say very nice things in front of us, but in the parliament, none of them ask even one half question, leave alone one question, in fact. My point is that we gave a right to children. This is the only right, fundamental right given to the children. we amended the constitution into the fundamental rights chapter. Fundamental rights chapter has been amended only once, only twice. Once for removing the property right, and this is the second time to include education right. And then the parliament members are not bothered about what they did. I need actually across the party lines, it is necessary not to fight on ideological grounds alone, that this is something for the children that we have committed. And why for the last 20 years, 2002, we did this amendment. There has been not even one full-fledged discussion on this. I have sat in many meetings on the consultative committees, many meetings of the standing committees. This question of why RTE is not being implemented has never come for discussion of that kind. They fight on the issues like whether there should be amendment to one of the RTE clauses, like no detention policy.
No detention.
It has a superficial thing that we are engaging with, but children are not getting the kind of education that is required. Government is not spending enough. Who will really make the government to do that? I don't think the civil society can do. I don't think this will become a common mobilization that can happen across, because this is the interest only of the marginalized group. This can happen only when it is taken up by a group of political leadership inside the parliament. Inside the parliament, that we passed a law, we passed this fundamental right, and why are we not engaged with this? I have a feeling that, you know, we need to create that kind of a feeling. When I said political class, I'm not saying that, you know, we are not concerned. There are parties which are concerned with this. I have interacted with many of them. I have a full understanding of those things. But that is not enough on this. Yeah. This has to be a non-partisan political grouping that has to emerge within the parliament to fight for, we did this and therefore we have to protect it. That right.
Fully agree with you, Professor, in that. Are there some strategies that we can work towards this? Are there some strategies that we can think of at least creating that, that movement within the political class, within the leadership? Is there some way that we can think about? There are some people at this particular government, even if big questions are asked a number of times, they can just brush it aside. They'll just pretend it's not there at all. That's been their strategy of moving things forward. I have one or two hands. Can I sort of see? I think Meera has raised her hand. And anyone else that also, would you like to unmute and
give your thoughts? Yeah. This is Meera. Actually, I'm sorry, I haven't got any strategy which you're asking, but I was trying to respond to something Aishi said about the philanthropists. I think it's a very dangerous sort of backdoor entry to private individuals and private groups to have a larger role, a little bit like the CSR allowed groups to come into the education system with no supervision, no accountability. So I was just wanting to confirm that I also felt that it's really not a benign clause at all, the entry of philanthropists. Thank you.
Thank you, Meera. Is there someone else that has raised their hand?
Can I speak, Ashish?
Yes, Ashish. I think we've not been able to hear someone else. Please go ahead.
Okay, thank you. I had a question for Govinda ji or Amrish ji, which is with regard to, I think one of the points that Govinda ji made was that in the short term, we can think of alternative education or learning spaces that communities can run or civil society can run or maybe even some government agencies. But I was thinking that maybe this could actually also be a long-term strategy, because if communities are empowered and issues of social justice and so on are dealt with, there are a number of examples around the country of this kind of alternative learning spaces within communities. But the problem many of them are facing is that the RTE has very straight-jacketed provisions for who can be a teacher, what kind of facilities in schools and so on. So when you have, let's say, so-called uneducated or illiterate community people who can actually be very, very good teachers, they're not allowed to have that kind of a thing under the RTE. So a number of these alternative spaces have actually either had to shut down or confirm to the RTE, which has created many problems for them. So is there any comment on that? How can we actually make the RTE itself more flexible to enable this kind of a community-based learning space?
I think this question whether RTE has really straitjacketed and prevented other possibilities of community-based education, or do we think that it is something of a facilitative process that we can move forward? I think that's an interesting question. Would Professor Govinda think
have I have also come across in many places complaining to me that saying that the RTE doesn't allow. This very much depends on the interpretation that the local authorities give. In fact, it is not that you need to really prohibit any kind of activity other than the school. It doesn't really, it's not like that. But if there is no school running properly, the school not running there at all and engaging with the children, you cannot prohibit that to happen. As I said, it all depends upon the interpretation of the local authorities. Unfortunately, we go for a very standardized rule making procedure at the state level, and states have issued those rules and regulations which prohibit, and then the local authorities don't want to take any initiative and then don't do it at all. This is what has happened. I agree with you that there is an element of suffocation that many organizations are feeling for alternates. But what I am pointing out now is that there is going to be a lot of spillover from the existing school system, which the schools will be unable to really deal with in many localities where the people have gone back and the villages and all. And I'm sure that this spillover will have to be handled outside the school through a non-formal channel. And how do we negotiate that channel is something that we need to work out, number one. Number two, I do agree that in the long run also, community-centeredness is a very critical requirement. And the RTE, if it is currently interpreted that community is not to be part of it, I think it is wrong. I think we need to really allow for it. If it is not happening, I think that is where if we need that some amendment has to happen, it should happen. How can community be kept out of primary education? It is impossible.
Thank you. We have, I think Sheetal has raised her hand. Can Sheetal come in to bring the point? Sheetal?
Actually, ma'am, I want to ask a question regarding the challenges which have been appeared during the pandemic about the adolescent or adults' educations. It is related to they have already, social barriers, and how we can bring them back to the schools, and is the current program which is implementing by the government are sufficient for bring them back to schools, or we have to think more about the girls? Majorly they have trapped in domestic work and other household work responsibility and facing inequality and other gender discrimination in the society. So how we can make effort to bring them back to the school, ma'am?
Aisha, would you like to take that comment?
Uh-huh. So the thing is that when we are talking about that, how women, the dropout rates, like we have addressed the issue that dropout rates will increase and there is a high possibility chances of dropout rates to increase. It is also important at this time, then we go to the local solutions to this that we are looking forward to. First of all, the government has to address the issue that the women, moreover the women, those who are there in the education sector, they won't be able to have a financial support or any other socioeconomic inequalities which will lead them to drop out. And for that, what we have been asking for continuously as student community is that the government has to extend financial support to the marginalized community, to the women, so that tomorrow none of the women, we know that many of us as women, we are continuing our education system because we ourselves are getting fellowships or scholarships and we are able to have that thought, or our families are having that thought that, okay, even if the child is going ahead with education system, they have a backdrop to support their education system. But at the same time, the government has to ensure that if, what is its primary idea? Its primary idea is to educate more women, then it has to immediately address the issues that dropout rates or the continuous domestic violence that is going on, that has to reduce. And if that has to reduce, what has to be ensured is proper awareness also among the families. And that can only happen, again, just like how Govinda sir was saying very correctly, the decentralized. The problem is we don't have a decentralized system in every state. The government says something, at ground we see some other policies happening, or there is no implementation of what is happening, even if sometimes if the government is saying something. So what is important at the ground level, at the root level, more of responsibility coming on the political representatives, the elected representatives, that they go and further decentralize the policies and ensure that none of the students, especially the marginalized and the women students, are dropped out of this system. Because there are certain, because I want to explain that there are certain socio-economic reasons of a person to drop it out. When one of the things that easily has been missed in the new education policy is how the government is saying that the students who don't want to continue education, they can easily get what the JNU system is of, after 2 years of your PhD, if you are done with your synopsis, you can drop out from the course and later come back and finish the PhD. So it's like the government in this new education policy is giving an easy way to it, that if students won't want to drop out now from the education system, they can, and later they can. But why they are dropping out, or why are they being forced to not continue their education, is something that we are not addressing to. Making an easy way out and saying that, okay, you can go for job, might also hamper the younger ages in a way. Because at this moment, if they don't have economic security, if they don't have social security, many of the students might be forced, especially there is reports coming that there has been increasing rate to child labor. We might see a lot of students ending up in informal sectors. So that might be hampering the system a lot. So this has to be seen, that how more in decentralized way we can address the socio-economic solutions, which eventually will give us a better understanding that how to bring back the students back to the university, rather than making the gap more of dropouts, which consistently we have seen has been happening.
Yeah, I think the dropout has really, I'll just come back to you. Also wanted Amrish to come in, because there is a persistent question, and maybe Govinda professor also, that there is this feeling that, the education system is in the current way because of the teachers who are involved in the system. I think a lot of times we do tend to place the responsibility on the teachers too, and that, the resources of the system is actually going to the teachers, and the teachers are not doing a full responsibility, particularly when it comes to children from marginalized communities. So your thought on that, and also the girl children and the dropout issue, request both Amrish and Professor Govinda to come in briefly on these two dimensions.
I'll just say about this question that was raised, about what happens when the high level of discrimination that is there, and how do we really engage that discrimination doesn't happen, gender discrimination and then other kinds of discrimination doesn't happen. I think it's a very critical question, and the world over experience tells us when there is a crisis, when there is scarcity, times of crisis and times of scarcity, what happens to this kind of behavior? And what tells us is that normally in such situation, intra-group solidarity increases, but inter-group discrimination also increases. This is what has been found. That means that the inter-caste discrimination is likely to increase. The discrimination against Dalits may increase. Whereas intra-group solidarity may increase also. I have no answer how exactly to deal with this, but this is a reality that emerges very often. And therefore, when we go from the civil society to deal with these kinds of things, we have to be extraordinarily cautious in terms of, so that, you know, we bring people together rather than increase that discriminatory behavior that is likely to emerge in this condition. That's what I wanted to say. About teacher, I think, you know, there is a lots of wrong notions. You know, we have developed in this country teacher bashing as a pastime. I think this is the only country where teachers and teacher education has been abandoned. No other country has abandoned in this fashion. And nobody bothers about a teacher, really speaking. Yeah, there may be 20% teachers who are really don't do anything and they boss over and then they really do all kinds of things. But majority of the teachers are neglected a lot. Many of them want to really do things, but they have no idea. You know, who are these teachers? Half the teachers are those people who have come from a system where we are finding that, you know, 50% children don't know what is to be learned even after 8 years of schooling. The other teachers are product of this kind of system. Many of them are college graduates, but they are not able to write anything properly. This speaks very highly, very well of the kind of quality of the college education that we are having. So I don't think simply unilaterally blaming teachers is going to solve the problem. I am not really saying that all teachers are great, but I think we need to engage with the teaching profession in greater depth and in a more intense fashion to transform the teacher profession. And I don't think we have enough program for teacher professional development. That is where the answer lies.
Amrishji, you want to come in?
Yeah, I just about the girls dropout. You know, the girls are very vulnerable in this crisis period. And because of the social norms, cultural norms, because of the patriarchy we have in our society, so the people are not willing to send in girls into the school. It was a big fight and it still continue. So bahut ladaiyon ke baad and the girl child is coming to the school, it is the struggle for her. She is struggling to come to the school, and our school should run in this manner to welcome all these girls and children coming from the deprived section. Going to school for them, it is a day-to-day struggle, you know. So they are coming. So now in this period, if you are not tracking these children through the communities, through the self-help group, through the SMCs, through the panchayats, you know, if you are not tracking, so there is a threat, there is a danger to we will look at a heavy dropout in this country, you know, of these children. Or abhi se shuru ho gaya hai, parents are started sending their children to for the rag picking, for the to the mechanical mechanics aur sab jagah bhejna unhone shuru kar diya hai. So the child labor dropout and the child marriage also is the it is a big threat for us. So pehli baat to ye hai ki we need to activate, I agree with Professor Govinda, that in the decentralized manner we should activate all these bodies, you know, which we built during the long period. Lekin hamare yahan mushkil ye hai ki just our political system is actually is going to be centralized. तो ये जो हमारे इस पूरी लड़ाई में, इस पूरे दौर में बहुत लोगों की जरूरत है उनको एक्टिवेट करने की, खास तौर से जो कम्युनिटी ऑर्गेनाइजेशंस हैं. बट आवर पॉलिटिकल लीडर्स, आवर स्टेट लीडर्स, दे आर नॉट डूइंग दिस. वो लोग बहुत सारा सेंट्रलाइज करते जा रहे हैं. तो अगर हम सेंट्रलाइज करते जाएंगे तो हाशिए पर खड़े हुए लोग छूट जाने का खतरा है, उसमें गर्ल्स भी एक है. क्योंकि एवरीथिंग इज गोइंग अराउंड वन और टू पर्सन, दैट वही बचा रहे हैं पूरा, उनका वर्डिक्ट चल रहा है एंड दे आर जस्ट पासिंग द ऑर्डर एंड एवरीबडी इज फॉलोइंग. सो इन द डेमोक्रेटिक मैनर वी आर नॉट फाइटिंग दिस बैटल. अगर ये बैटल हम डेमोक्रेटिक मैनर में फाइट नहीं करेंगे और कम्युनिटी ऑर्गेनाइजेशंस को एक्टिव नहीं करेंगे तो ये खतरा रहेगा, बहुत सारा खतरा रहेगा कि हमारे बच्चे छूट जाएंगे, हमारे गरीब लोग छूट जाएंगे, हमारे किसान और मजदूर छूट जाएंगे, हमारे माइग्रेंट लोग जो है वो पूरे प्लानिंग से बाहर हो जाएंगे. एंड दैट्स व्हाई इन दिस पीरियड वी नीड टू ब्रिंग ऑल पीपल टुगेदर, सभी को एक साथ लाने की जरूरत है, जबकि हम ये काम नहीं कर रहे हैं और ये बहुत ही खतरा है. तो इसलिए लड़कियों की शिक्षा को, लड़कियों के ड्रॉप आउट का एक बहुत बड़ा खतरा है, तो कम्युनिटीज के जरिए उनको ट्रैक करें. जस्ट आई सा ए रिपोर्ट रिलीज्ड बाय नोबेल लॉरेट मलाला दैट द होल वर्ल्ड 10 मिलियन गर्ल्स विल बी ड्रॉप्ड आउट इन ड्यूरिंग due to this coronavirus in the world. तो ये एक बहुत बड़ा खतरा है. अगर 1 करोड़ मतलब एक बहुत बड़ी संख्या है अगर लड़कियां शिक्षा से बाहर हो जाएंगी, तो ये इसलिए ये काम हमको करने की जरूरत है. और गवर्नमेंट को थोड़ा और अपने सिस्टम को और अपने मिजाज को डेमोक्रेटाइज और डिसेंट्रलाइज मैनर में सामने लाना होगा, एक बात. दूसरी बात, जो टीचर्स की बात आप कह रहे हैं, ये टीचर्स देखिए सैलरी कम करने से क्वालिटी बढ़ जाएगी इसकी कोई गारंटी नहीं है. यू हैव टू पे ए डिग्निफाइड सैलरी एवरीबडी, जो भी है. डॉक्टर को कम पैसा दीजिएगा तो मरीज से अच्छा व्यवहार करेगा हॉस्पिटल में, दिस इज नॉट द वे. एवरीबडी एंड वी आर अगेंस्ट दिस लो पेड अनक्वालिफाइड टीचर्स. वी हैव लॉट ऑफ कॉन्ट्रेक्चुअल टीचर इन दिस वे. बात ये नहीं है, कमजोरी कहीं और है जिसको हम टीचर्स में, बिकॉज टीचर्स आर डीमोटिवेटेड नाउ. टीचर्स आर डीमोटिवेटेड, टीचर ट्रेनिंग नहीं, जैसा प्रोफेसर गोविंदा ने कहा कि टीचर ट्रेनिंग, ओरिएंटेशन, टीचर्स को कैरिकुलम टेक्स्ट बुक में इन्वॉल्व करना, टीचर्स आर डूइंग सो मेनी वर्क. अभी हमने सुना कि किसी स्टेट में टीचर्स की ड्यूटी लगाई जाने वाली है शराब बेचने के लिए. कैन यू इमेजिन दिस, टीचर्स आर गोइंग टू सेल द वाइन, उसकी ड्यूटी लगाई जाएगी. टीचर्स की ड्यूटी आप बहुत सारी जगहों पे लगा देते हैं और काम करते, तो इसलिए टीचर्स का ओरिएंटेशन, टीचर्स का मोटिवेशन, योर डाइट्स आर नॉट फंक्शनल, इन सर्विस ट्रेनिंग का कोई सिस्टम नहीं है, कोई मॉड्यूल नहीं है. टीचर्स को आप और एजुकेशनल एक्टिविटीज में कैसे इन्वॉल्व करें, इसका कोई आपके पास प्लानिंग नहीं है. इफ यू हैव नो प्लानिंग, तो आप ना तो टीचर से काम ले सकते हैं, ना डॉक्टर से काम ले सकते हैं, ना किसी से भी काम नहीं ले सकते, क्योंकि आपको ये प्लानिंग बनाना होगा. तो दैट्स व्हाई, तो सैलरी उनका कम कर दिया जाए, पैसे उनके कम कर दिए जाए, इससे टीचर्स क्वालिटी का काम बढ़ जाएगा और क्वालिटी बढ़ जाएगी. ये संभव नहीं है, ये मुझे नहीं लगता. हाँ, मॉनिटरिंग कीजिए. यू हैव टू बिल्ड ए मैकेनिज्म टू मॉनिटर द टीचर, लेकिन मॉनिटरिंग सर्वेलांस के जरिए नहीं. यू हैव टू जस्ट परस्यू देम, यू हैव टू ओरिएंट देम, you have to come involve into the system. आपको पता होना चाहिए कि कोई भी पॉलिसी बनती है, इवन दिस नेशनल एजुकेशन पॉलिसी, दे आर मेकिंग दिस नेशनल एजुकेशन पॉलिसी, बट दे आर नॉट कंसल्टिंग विद द टीचर्स, दे आर नॉट बदर, दे हैव नो बदर अबाउट देयर ओपिनियन. तो इसलिए टीचर्स को इन पॉलिसी मेकिंग प्रोसेस में कभी इन्वॉल्व नहीं किया गया. यू आर ट्रीटिंग टीचर्स एज ए, हम कहते हैं कि टीचर्स आर द चेंज मेकर, और एंड यू आर डीलिंग टीचर्स लाइक ए गवर्नमेंट सर्वेंट, लाइक ए गवर्नमेंट स्टाफ. यू आर नॉट कंसीडरिंग दैट टीचर्स आर द चेंज मेकर. टीचर्स कैन डू अ लॉट विद द सोसाइटी. यू आर नॉट थिंकिंग लाइक दैट. यू हैव टू ब्रिंग बैक द डिग्निटी ऑफ टीचर इन प्लेस, एंड देन यू कैन मॉनिटर, यू कैन ओरिएंट, यू कैन परस्यू देम to just for a quality teaching. तो ये काम government को करना होगा उनके साथ, और ये आप अगर नहीं करेंगे तो फिर ये संभव नहीं है. Thank you.
Okay, another 5 minutes. I think we had one or two questions. One was Jharkhandi Chacha. I think he'd been trying to raise a question or a point for some time. And Shatai also wanted to raise a point. And then I think we will wind up the discussion, coming to some next steps forward.
Is it audio, ma'am?
Yes.
मैं एक स्टोरी बताना चाहूंगा अपना दोस्त का. वो अभी एक स्कूल चला रहा है गुमला डिस्ट्रिक्ट में, झारखंड में. तो वहाँ जितने भी टीचर्स जो आते हैं उन लोगों को वो पेड नहीं करता है. हाँ, तो उसके में जितने भी टीचर्स आते हैं सारे वॉलंटरी बेसिस पे आते हैं. और मैं उस जगह से हूँ इसलिए मुझे पता है वहाँ का शिक्षा का लेवल. तो जैसे कि गवर्नमेंट तो नहीं सीख रही है, तो जैसे कि गवर्नमेंट कुछ कर तो नहीं रही है, तो गवर्नमेंट को हम लोगों से सीखने की जरूरत है. एक्चुअली मैं वो कहना चाहूंगा.
तो आई थिंक बेसिकली यही इसका यही है कि कम्युनिटी में वो पोटेंशियल और इंटरेस्ट है पढ़ाई को आगे ले जाने के लिए. कैसे हम इसको सरकार के साथ या सरकार इसको कैसे रिकॉग्नाइज करेंगे, आई थिंक दैट इज वन क्रिटिकल. आई थिंक इट इज अगेन एंड अगेन कमिंग अप कि सरकार सुनने के लिए, एक्नॉलेज करने के लिए बिल्कुल तैयार ही नहीं है. तो वो पॉलिटिकल इंटरेस्ट हम कैसे बनाएंगे, किसके साथ बनाएंगे, आई थिंक दैट सीम्स टू बी अ मेजर डिस्कशन एंड अ स्ट्रेटजी फॉरवर्ड दैट वी हैव टू बिल्ड अप. एंड आरटी फोरम, डू यू सी एनी वे टू डू दैट, अमरीश जी? हाउ डू वी क्रिएट दिस यू नो डिमांड और कंपल्शन ऑन द पॉलिटिकल स्टेक होल्डर्स टू रियली take that forward? Is a strategy that we can build forward on this, do you feel?
No, I think we have to make education a prominent agenda within the society and in the political circle. If we put this, agar hum ye bana payenge to wo ek bada issue ban jayega. Otherwise agar hum isko केवल पॉलिसी में ही देखने की, पॉलिसी भी तभी इम्पैक्ट होगा जब बाहर से इस पर प्रेशर पड़ेगा. तो मुझे लगता है कि एक बड़े जन आंदोलन के लिए कम्युनिटी ऑर्गेनाइजेशंस को स्ट्रेंथन करना, उनको इन्वॉल्व करना, उनको एजुकेशन के बहुत सारे मूवमेंट्स में, जैसे एसएमसी इज ए वंडरफुल स्ट्रक्चर प्रोवाइडेड बाई द आरटी. एसएमसी कैन बी play an executive role to mobilize the communities, to mobilize all community members. और ये लेकर के अगर हम कर सकें और local जो political leaders हैं उनके साथ community engage करें. If you can build such type of network within the community and mobilize them to engage with the local political people. क्योंकि लोकल पॉलिटिकल पीपल कैन प्रेशराइज देयर स्टेट एंड नेशनल पॉलिटिकल पर्संस. यहाँ हम जैसा प्रोफेसर गोविंदा ने कहा कि यहाँ एमपीज को हम बुलाते हैं, उनके साथ बात करते हैं, सब करते हैं, वो लंबी लंबी बातें भी करते हैं, वायदे भी करते हैं और पार्लियामेंट में जाके वो भूल जाते हैं और वो ये चिंता नहीं करते कि उनके द्वारा इनैक्ट किया हुआ एक्ट जो है 10 साल के बाद केवल 12% स्कूलों में लागू हुआ है. एंड नोबडी इज गोइंग टू जस्ट कोई प्राइवेट मोशन भी मूव नहीं करता पार्लियामेंट के अंदर कि पार्लियामेंट शुड डिस्कस दिस. ये एक दो नहीं है, 27 करोड़ स्कूल गोइंग चिल्ड्रन का फ्यूचर का सवाल है. एंड ऑल एजुकेशन, ऑल लेवल ऑफ एजुकेशन इज बेस्ड ऑन द प्राइमरी एजुकेशन. एंड इफ प्राइमरी एजुकेशन इज नॉट गुड एनफ एंड नॉट स्ट्रांग, सो हाउ कैन बिल्ड सेकेंडरी एंड हायर एजुकेशन? तो इस पर लेकिन कोई भी मूव करने को तैयार नहीं होता. इसलिए कम्युनिटी मोबिलाइजेशन एंड एंगेजिंग विद द लोकल पॉलिटिकल लीडर्स एंड मेकिंग एजुकेशन ए प्राइम इशू विद इन दैट एरियाज, ये हेल्प करेगा एंड वी कैन कनेक्ट ऑल नेटवर्क्स टुगेदर. स्टूडेंट ऑर्गेनाइजेशन, दे कैन, स्टूडेंट ऑर्गेनाइजेशन दे हैव देयर वेरी पावरफुल वॉइसेज. यूनिवर्सिटीज आर the spaces for the critical thinking, raising the issues, involving the with the downtrodden, deprived sections. Lekin unko primary school education apna agenda banana padega. Because student organization, they are busy with the higher education things. This disconnect we have to isko khatam karna hoga. And student organization, main AISF mein tha to maine बनारस से देहरादून तक साइकिल रैली और 2000 लोगों ने दून स्कूल पर प्रदर्शन किया था उस जमाने में, कि हमने कहा था कि दून स्कूल इज द source of this establishing the dual education system. So इसको बंद करो. उस समय हम लोगों का जो आवाज थी. तो इसलिए student movement को ये disconnect खत्म करना होगा between primary, secondary and higher education. The whole education is under the crisis. So we have to look at whole education, because whole government is going to privatize whole education everywhere. Higher, technical, secondary and primary schools, they all handing over the private sector and privatizing and making the path for the pro-profit private sector. So student organizations can take the issue, communities can take the issue, and the all mass organizations like trade unions, like other organizations, because education is linked, associated with the all. So that is the, I think, we can create a bias among the country, among society, for strengthening a public education system, public resources, more and more for public resources. Because if public education system will be weakened, so deprived section, they will be deprived from the getting the education, because they are only dependent on the public education system. They have no money to get to buy education from the market. तो उनका तो सारा जो है जीव शिक्षा का सारा भार ही इसी पर है. उनको मोबिलाइज करना होगा. एंड आई थिंक दे कैन टेक ए बिग रोल, द दलित ऑर्गेनाइजेशन, ट्राइबल ऑर्गेनाइजेशन. की बाबा साहब तो शिक्षित हो, संगठित हो, संघर्ष करो, पहला स्लोगन ही उनका एजुकेशन का था. तो उन सबको भी हम कैसे इसमें इन्वॉल्व करें दैट ऑर्गेनाइजेशन. This is a big task, and this is a necessary task for building a new India. If you are moving towards new normal, so we need to make education a political prime agenda in this country with the help of all these forces. Tabhi kuch ho sakta hai, otherwise nothing will be happen. And I am very hopeful that now in the new situation when India will be open, so the mass movements from different sector will march together, and they will make some changes. Thank you.
I would like to just maybe we take this little 2 minutes to wind up. First of all, I think there is a huge role and responsibility that education movements need to play at this time. And that role is not just limiting ourselves to education movements, but really moving beyond education movements and education activists to the other communities that are keen on education, particularly the vulnerable and marginalized communities. I think a strategy of engaging those movements has to be really built up. I think you have rightly placed that, but we need a strategy for that, Amrishji. How do we reach out? How do we engage with these movements where education is so important? And I think, like you have also mentioned, the students, the universities. I think the other side of students and universities are the young people in the marginalized communities. They are not going to the universities, but they have had some level of education in their communities. So how do we mobilize this educated youth within the marginalized communities, and how do we create a voice among them and strengthen them to particularly engage with the local political leaders and create a demand and compulsion on them? I think that would also be important. And as Aisha said, I think it's very important to look at a multi-stakeholder group from university students, from communities, movements, organizations. And I think from what the three panelists and the responses have come, our strategies and our direction are more or less the same, that we do recognize education as the foundation for the type of society. We look at community-centered and decentralized education. We look at public investments as the important role for moving education. We look at a political stakeholding on education from the, from the leadership. So I don't think there is difference in the kind of demands that we have. But maybe our strategies, we need to relook at our strategies on how we can create that wider mass and mobilization. And maybe that's really some level of strategic rethinking and redesigning at this time that we can create to move forward. I would really like to thank Professor Govinda for
for really engaging and giving us some very thought-provoking ideas. Aisha, for coming in both as a student leader and as a woman leader to highlight the kind of potential and the issues that higher education and the larger system has. And for Amrish ji, with all your experience on education, to bring together these dimensions. But I think the task is clear. We need to really build our strategies onto it. And the next 2-3 months would really be critical for us, because that's when the pandemic is going to be really the highlight of the issues. And beyond that, then to put those plans into action. I'd like to thank the organizers, Center for Finance Accountability, Maju and Priya and all the others, and also all the participants. I think we're all very, 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 very close. Education is something so close to our hearts. So looking at possibilities, possible ways in which we can move forward. Thank you so much for the kind of thoughts. Thank you so much for the continuous engagement, and look forward to building a strategy that we can really mobilize forward. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Annie ma'am, for steering the discussion, asking the pertinent questions, and linking things together. It was such an informative discussion on the whole. So thank you once again, the moderator who steered the discussion. The next webinar will be on Universal Healthcare Dream or Reality, Challenges and Learning on Public Health System in India in the Present Pandemic. This would be on 10th July, which is the coming Friday. And the speakers will be Dr. Vandana, Dr. Abhay Shukla, and Amitabh Guha. The session will be moderated by Amulya Nidhi. So we welcome all of you to the next webinar as well. The issues of education, health, and public investments, and public investments in education and health will also decide the future society. The recording of this webinar will also be available at our website, www.cenfa.org/rtf, senfa.org, and it's also will be there in the Facebook as Facebook Live. So thank you everyone who have participated, who raised questions. Much of the questions will also be addressed when we consolidate these webinars to create the agenda document, and we would get in touch with many of you. Thank you. Thank you all. Thank you once again.
Thank you.